and once again, thank you very much for coming along to EcoViews and News. Today we want to think of the two things that are linked very clearly in current events. That is the recovery and the discovery of what's going on with tropical storms like Sandy that hit New York, and the international effort to try to do something about limiting carbon emissions. So it's going to be focusing on both what's happened recently in the United States and what hasn't happened internationally and what isn't happening. That's the tragedy. We're having another round of the Conference of Parties, COP as it's called. COP18 is taking place in Doha, in Qatar, in the Middle East. And basically, everyone has very pessimistic assessment of what it's going to mean, that we haven't arrived yet at the point where governments are moving to limit the emissions of carbon. And yet, unrestrained, the emissions of carbon are going to cause more and more climate catastrophes of the kind we just recently saw in Tropical Storm Sandy. It was a hurricane when it was in the ocean, but when it hit the land, it was a tropical storm. So we're going to look at this question of wake-up calls and tipping points, because at some point you've got to ask yourself, okay, who's got the wake-up call here? And haven't we been able to mobilize yet in reference to all these wake-up calls? And at some point, the wake-up calls get beyond the tipping point. That is to say, this gets into a circumstance where humans will have nothing to say about it once certain thresholds are met in the ecosystem. Once the ice melts beyond a certain point, it's not clear it will recover within geologic time. It may take tens of thousands of years, and we may be well on the way to severe climate circumstances, a regime that we've never seen as human beings since the emergence in the last 10,000 years of urban civilization. Well, we can ask the question right off the bat, was Katrina a wake-up call? Well, certainly for the scientists it was, and they've been saying so for quite a while. In fact, it's possible to see that they've linked what happened in New Orleans with what's likely to happen in Miami, Baltimore, New York, Boston, all up the East Coast. They were saying this for quite a while. In fact, it's sobering to try to look back and see what they were saying. This was a documentary made in 2007, but I'll bring it up here if I can, just to look at it a moment, so you can see what was involved here. It's pretty dramatic. Ever since the early 2001, really, they're warning out from a series of people, and I'll try to capture them here in excerpt form so we can take a look at it. But basically, the crisis has come because of the rate at which polar ice caps are melting. Let's take a look. It's pretty extraordinary. This was a summary program made on the National Geographic Channel.
The big melt is on. Mountain glaciers are shrinking in the Himalayas, the Andes, the Alps, and in North America.
We only have 27 glaciers left out of the original 150 that were estimated to be here.
And scientists say the ominous picture doesn't end here.
The climate is literally spinning out of control.
Melting glaciers will lead to rising oceans and killer storms. And like the mythical Atlantis, American cities could be swallowed by the sea.
The Jefferson Memorial will be under 15 feet of water. I mean, water will go up to the outskirts of the White House.
Okay, now this is a projection well before Katrina occurred, that the water could well go up to the steps of the White House, that the Jefferson Memorial would be underwater. Why? Well, because two things are happening simultaneously. The ice is melting from the polar ice caps, and they're emphasizing here from glaciers. And at the same time, sea surface levels are heating up. Now, sea surface levels are what, in effect, the temperature drives the emergence of hurricanes. So you can have more and more severe weather on a rising base of ocean level. That means you're going to have storm surges with more powerful storms coming off a higher ocean, and you're going to have some pretty dramatic movements of water onto land. The way they forecast it is really worth looking at in detail. Let's see if we can pick it up from another point in the documentary to give you a sense of this. Let's see. Okay, here we go.
Scientists are predicting a rise in sea level of 1, 2, or even 3 feet by the end of the century. But if a significant portion of the polar ice caps melts, it could be much more.
It's not totally unrealistic to think that sea level rise could be maybe up to 10 feet between now and 2100. There's a lot of ice in Western Antarctica. It's grounded below sea level, and it's inherently unstable. So we are concerned that it could slip away very rapidly. And this alone could raise sea level by 15 feet.
Low-lying coastal areas could be devastated. Entire island nations in the South Pacific could be swallowed by the sea. In Bangladesh, the rice paddies that feed millions of people could disappear under salt water. Untold numbers of these people could be displaced and become
become, now this is very interesting, the phraseology. We can pause it here a sec. These people could become, as they say in this documentary, listen to the phrase.
Climate refugees.
Climate refugees.
And some of America's great cities, Miami, Baltimore, New York, and Boston, may see their most expensive waterfront properties washed away. Even worse, warmer oceans will cause more intense tropical storms and hurricanes.
Hurricane is a heat engine. It's a monster that devours heat, and it gets it from the upper layers of the ocean. And
so this isn't a mystery. A hurricane is a heat engine. Gets it from the upper layers of the ocean, and it moves it from the tropics to the northern latitudes. Now, this is pretty staggering when you look at it, because it's this that will drive these severe weather storms, and it's the low-lying areas that are going to feel it. Now, they've actually done some calculations about what it would look like for the Northeast. They outline the vulnerability of the whole East Coast, but then they talk specifically about the Northeast. Take a look.
Argo data indicates that the oceans are warming at an alarmingly rapid rate. For low-lying coastal regions, this warming trend could be devastating. In the U.S., the Gulf Coast, and especially New Orleans, are at extreme risk.
I think it's the most dangerous city in the world to live in. Katrina, too, is inevitable because we failed to learn even one lesson from that hurricane, and that is rebuild the levees, rebuild the wetlands and barrier islands, and stop global warming. We're not doing any of that.
With an eye toward the future, scientists have attempted to predict what a 3-foot rise in sea level would mean for some of our cities. To illustrate the impact that a hurricane might have, an engineering firm called Open Science Associates has generated computer visualizations of a Category 2 storm. The U.S. Geological Survey supplied data on the elevation and topography of each city. The National Hurricane Center provided its sea...
Now, this is a model that they use, the National Hurricane Center. It's called the Sea, Land, and Lake model, and so it's referred to by its acronym, and you'll see him refer to it as SLOSH. sounds like a parody, but it's not. I mean, this is the name of the model that they use here. Look at how he describes it.
Like an overland surges from hurricanes, or slosh model results, to determine the maximum storm surge elevation as it floods cities along the coast.
Anybody who feels safe even watching New Orleans disappear as a viable city should not feel safe, because your city could be next.
Okay, now, it looks like the call has clearly been a wake-up call ever since New Orleans, and anybody who feels safe should not feel safe, as this scientist says. Actually, the journalist reporting on what the scientist has said. But listen, anyone who feels safe, he says, should not feel safe, because your city is next. Okay. The warning came out there. After Katrina, but was anyone listening to Katrina as a general wake-up call, or just a wake-up call for the Gulf Coast? In fact, it's a general wake-up call.
In New York, a Category 2 storm could cause a 17-foot surge, flooding much of Lower Manhattan, including Wall Street and Ground Zero. In Boston, such a storm could generate a 14-foot surge, submerging much of the historic North End and Financial District. And in Miami, just a 3-foot surge would inundate Key Biscayne, South Beach, and Miami Beach.
Okay, well, those are the three East Coast cities that they focused on, Miami, Boston, and New York. And as you know from the Sandy coverage, you've probably experienced a 14-foot surge. Now, this was a simulation that said that's what a 17-foot surge would look like if a Category 2 hurricane hit New York. Well, as it turned out, it was a tropical storm, not a Category 2 hurricane, and the surge was 14 feet, not 17 feet. But you can see we're well within the range of these models here, and you start looking at some of those models, especially for a place like Boston, and you realize we're very vulnerable. The projections that they had there for Boston were for only a 14-foot storm surge with a Category 2. Well, a 14-foot storm surge is what they got in New York, and we're very fortunate that it didn't come up in this direction with that kind of force. Because we would have been under all of that water portrayed in the data from that simulation. Take a look at the way it was projected. It was, in fact, on this level, suggested New York would be for a 17-foot surge. But for a 14-foot one, the
A monster storm, almost 1,000 miles wide.
This is going to be.
We'll recover that in a moment. In Boston, it was set in 2006. They projected a 14-foot storm surge, which is the amount that hit New York in Sandy. If that were up here, this is what it would look like. Boston would look like. It would become the islands once again that it was in the colonial period. All of this is filled land. The neck that goes out to Washington Street to that former island part, all of that, all of the back bay is a bay, as you can see, and all of that would be underwater if we had been hit as New York had been hit. And that's just a 1 degree difference in the trajectory of the storm from the Mediterranean. If it had moved in 1 degree further northwards, or if the intervening high pressure had behaved in a different way over Labrador. Well, this is causing some scientists to spend a lot of time looking at what they're calling the sea ice reduction as a tipping point. They put forward the notion that a tipping point is some point beyond which you can't come back, basically. Take a look. I mean, as Arctic sea ice hits a record low, scientific focus is turning to climate tipping points, a threshold that once crossed cannot be reversed. If too much of that ice goes, it won't regenerate itself in the summer, and in effect, it'll turn to a warmer surface. The ocean dark surface will absorb more and more heat not reflected off as a white surface of ice does, and it'll be a tipping point beyond which recovery is not possible. So you might ask yourself, was Tropical Storm Sandy a wake-up call? Well, there are some people who argue that it is, and it was scenes like this in New Jersey and New York that have called scientists to focus upon it, and people like Simon Boxall have suggested that, in fact, we now realize that for some, at least, in New York, this registered as a huge wake-up call. Let's see the way he put it, if we can recover it for the moment. It's a story that has just been coming out, and in fact, may take a while to get through to the public at large. But the impact within Boston of what's going on in New Jersey and New York should be the wake-up call. Take a look at the devastation.
This is Lock Harbor. It's just next to Asbury Park, just west along the coast. And we're only about 25, 30 meters from the sea at the moment. It's usually further out because of the surge. See what happened here last night. The water just swept in, it's gone straight through some of the building. Really quite devastating damage. We look at this building here in particular, and we just spoke to a police officer. What he told us happened, the water just came straight in through the surge. It was a lot higher than normal. It came in around this way, and in some places it's just washed out entire rooms, and you can see straight through this building. It's washed out an interior wall, washed out doors, furniture, and then as the water's receded, it's just left mountains of sand. Sand's about 3 or 4 feet deep in places. And we're going to walk around the back of this house in particular. This seems to have been the worst damaged on the strip. This neighborhood actually only runs about 3 streets. There's only maybe 20, maybe slightly more houses in here. And you can see straight inside through this. This was obviously a wall. Just everything piled up there. It's really a testament to the power of the ocean.
A testament to the power of the ocean. Well, you can bet it is. The question is whether we're doing anything in response to it. Well, Boxall says it should be a wake-up call, and apparently Governor Cuomo thinks...
breakdown in terms of numbers, our recovery cost is about $32
billion. $32 billion, according to the governor. And he now expects to spend another $9 to try to prevent this happening in the future.
Originally, we had estimated it to be about 30, so it's right about where we thought it would be. A prevention and mitigation package of about $9 billion for a total recovery of $41 billion.
Now, when you combine that with what New Jersey is expecting, which is about $38 billion, they're going to be going down to Washington to ask for severe storm damage recovery. Well, this is happening as people in that whole area, like Jennifer Francis from Rutgers University, who have been monitoring sea ice, have been pointing out it's part of a new state of affairs. This was an interview
on September 19, 2012,
system.
The National Snow and Ice Data Center declared the annual sea ice minimum, with the lowest extent of Arctic sea ice ever seen in the modern record.
I would almost argue that we might be entering into a new climate state. Now, what is causing us to lose more of that winter ice cover every summer? Is it that you have these feedback processes starting to kick in? I mean, some argue that the ice is very thin anyway, so that it melts out easier in the summertime as well.
Now, Yale puts these things out on a regular basis, and it's worth following them when you can get access to them.
The white stuff that you can see in the middle of the ocean here is the ice that's over 9 years old. As you go up into the bluer shades, the ice gets younger and younger. And starting, you can see the date here, we're still in the 1980s. You can see how that thick ice is being driven right out into the Atlantic Ocean. There's less and less of the old ice now. We're here still in the 1990s. And as that AO continues to drive all the thick ice out of the Arctic Ocean, you see that we're left with less and less of it. Getting up into the 2000s now, the Arctic is mostly filled with much younger ice. As we get right up to the present day, practically, and here we are today, basically you see that there's hardly any of that thick ice left.
Hardly any of the thick ice left, and that's the ice that, in effect, is now changing the temperature of the sea surface as it melts, and as the scientists are pointing out, we're getting very close to tipping points. Alarming year of extremes as climate tipping points looms is the headline here. UN groups issue stark warnings at climate summit in Doha. Now that's what's taking place. Started last week, it's going through this next week. People like this from Oxford are trying to say, listen, we need to extend the protocol, the Kyoto Protocol, to limit greenhouse gases and start taxing carbon. But there isn't much support for that. Ruth Davis from Greenpeace and others have been pointing out that it's a very weak government commitment to this so far. And yet global warming is clearly happening. How are we going to get the public focused on this? Well, even in Doha, which is a pretty authoritarian regime, there's been an effort to try to organize protests.
Part of climate change talks, the opportunity to hold public protest is rare in Qatar. But with the world's attention on the country for the COP18 conference, non-government and activist groups were granted permission to demonstrate on Doha's Corniche.
The general message of the march is to all the leaders of the world that if Qatar, the gas, natural gas, economic-based country, highest polluter per capita, is being positive about climate change and leading to change and allowing a march for the first time in its history, what are your reasons not to save planet Earth?
The tightly controlled march closed sections of a main road, the rallying call for climate justice.
More action! More action!
The small but passionate group of protesters have a clear message for the climate negotiators. They want Qatar and other Gulf states to take more of an active role and set an example. They also want the negotiators to listen to the scientists and act before the window of opportunity closes.
Okay, now that's a pretty clear statement, asking for Arab leadership on this. The Western world has completely abdicated their role as leaders in this. And now Arab activists are saying, look, Qatar, take the lead and show the Western world that you can limit carbon. Got to limit carbon. Listen to the scientists. Now, these are a group of Arab activists who are asking the world community, especially the leaders of governments assembled there in Doha, to listen to the scientists. So if the wake-up call is anywhere, it's not taking root here in the States. It's happening in groups of Arab activists in the Middle East. I mean, this is a pretty extraordinary reversal of traditions here. But we got to keep an eye on it. Wake-up calls and tipping points. We may be getting beyond the tipping points, and it may be too late for the wake-up calls. This is something that's generating itself at a level we haven't been able to get the public outraged about yet. The obvious thing is that politicians need to move, but politicians won't move, as we've seen in a recent election, until the people lead. When the people lead, the politicians follow. So it's time to raise the public level of outrage on this kind of thing. We'll be covering this as we go along here, so keep in touch with the BeLive program, EcoViews and News. Thanks very much for coming along. See you next week.
Thank you.